subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Yoga event is held here.
Severe injustice, and they should be stopped.
We should raise our voices.
Condemn this brutal act.
I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. Pakistan is not just systematically plundering the resource-rich Balochistan of its minerals, but is working at an extensive multi-pronged design to push Baloch towards a political catastrophe. As if the absence of fundamental rights, social security and employment wasn't enough, the establishment is now denying them education. It does not want Balochs to read, write and grow into informed, efficient and employable mass. While the quality of a handful of higher education institutions in Balochistan has degraded considerably owing to system's apathy, the universities in other provinces are now denying them admissions. The quota has been abolished without notice. There has been a backlash, but authorities haven't moved an inch. Students have taken up a protest march, which they say will go till Islamabad if authorities do not roll back their decision.
This marching group of students sloganeering against systemic injustice are Baloch students who have high educational aspirations. But the state is not letting them learn beyond a limit. They have been denied admission in the government universities across Pakistan. The universities that provided them quota seats until last year have rejected their applications with no notice or alternative. Universities say they have run out of funds to accommodate scholarships. Students call it a systemic conspiracy and discrimination. In protest, they are now holding weeks-long march, which will traverse through prominent Pakistan cities before culminating in capital Islamabad. Students say they decided to march across the country after their repeated requests of restoration of seats fell on deaf ears.
Many of the students belonging from Balochistan do not afford higher education. And Balochistan have least number of universities as compared to the other provinces of Pakistan. After intermediate, many of the students from middle class families cannot afford the heavy fees and leave their education. Due to the educational backwardness in Balochistan, quota seats were provided in different universities of the Punjab. But this year, administration of Bahauddin Zakir University Multan abolished these seats and said we cannot afford the expenses of this scholarship. We protested against this decision in front of the Bahauddin Zakir University main gate, where we demanded the restoration of these seats, but no one listened to us. We took a strict step and decided to march towards Islamabad via Lahore.
Balochs, who already accuse Pakistan of systematic discrimination against them, say that the establishment has now extended its suppressive designs to education. Pakistani authorities don't want Balochs to read and write, for they fear that containing a rebellion by an informed and educated mass will be beyond their capacities. Even the primary and secondary education of the region has been in shambles. While the infrastructure is crumbling, enrollment is disappointingly dismal. The the largest province Balochistan has a total of just 9 universities, including the private ones, against the colossal figure of 67 in Punjab province. This determined lot says that it will not give up until the seats and the dignity is restored.
We have been marching for last 3 days and covered approximately 110 kilometers. We are our way towards Lahore, and if still government do not take actions and restore our seats, then we take our way to the capital city of the country, that is Islamabad.
It is not just that the Baloch students are not getting admission into universities, but the entire academia hailing from the region is at the target of Pakistan Army and its proxies. Pakistan's devious designs have been exposed in their recent acts, where they have exclusively kidnapped, tortured and killed educated Baloch youth. And this systematic violence has been upgraded in the backdrop of China-Pakistan economic corridor that has witnessed a considerable resistance from Balochs. As per observers, only one thing out of Balochs and Pakistan's economic ambitions can sustain in Balochistan: a debt-ridden Islamabad seems to have made its choices. Balochs do not matter to it.
Moving on. With a relatively lower COVID caseload, India is walking the talk of a comprehensive fight against the pandemic. And it is not just about the government claims. Iconic Taj Mahal, one of the modern wonders, is now receiving more footfalls as compared to what it witnessed previous month when it was reopened after 6 months. While the number of daily infections has dropped in past 2 weeks, the government is now focusing at preventing fatalities. It aims to bring it down below 1%.
Tourist influx in India's Taj Mahal city, Agra, has witnessed a surge. Officials say the numbers have gone up by 25 to 30% as compared to previous month. The Monument of Love was reopened after 6 months on 21st September. People have become relatively confident after a considerable decline in the daily infections that had reached nearly 100,000 per day for at least 2 weeks. It is around 50,000 per day now. Superintending Archaeologist of Archaeological Survey of India, Basant Kumar, said that generally all tickets to the monument are being sold every day and other monuments are also witnessing a turn up.
निश्चित रूप से जब ताजमहल हमने खोला था या अन्य स्मारक जब खुले थे उसकी तुलना में हम देखें तो पिछले हफ्ते में दर्शकों में 25 से 30% की बढ़ोतरी हुई है और जो हमारी लिमिट है टिकटों की वो लगभग ताजमहल में तो पूरी हो जा रही है, अन्य जगहों पर भी दर्शक निरंतर बढ़ते चले जा रहे हैं।
Tourism is a key to Indian economy and has been instrumental in the swift GDP growth the country has witnessed over time. World Travel and Tourism Council data shows that tourism contributed about $240 billion or 9.2% of India's gross domestic product in 2018, employing more than 42 million people. While the Government of India has been pushing for reopening of the market to make up for the huge losses it has incurred, it is also working at a holistic strategy aimed at further curbing the menace of virus. apart from bringing down the positive numbers, the authorities are now working at bringing down the fatality rate. Despite climbing cases, Indian fatality rate is already among the lowest in the world.
हमने उनके साथ बैठक करके ये स्ट्रेटजी बनाई है कि यहाँ किस प्रकार के विशेष उपाय किए जाने चाहिए जिससे इन मृत्यु दर को जो बढ़ रही है, खास स्थानों पर बढ़ रही है, उसको कैसे नियंत्रण में लाया जाए, कैसे नीचे लाया जाए, क्योंकि देश में हमारा जो लक्ष्य है वो 1% केस फेटेलिटी रेट का है.
The country's health ministry says that it is expecting to get its hands on vaccine by early next year and is drawing a plan for its fifth distribution, keeping vulnerable groups priority. Meanwhile, Serum Institute, the largest vaccine manufacturer of the world, which is conducting phase 2 and 3 trials of the Oxford COVID-19 vaccine, has sought approval to expand the scope of vaccine trials in India. It wants elderly and vulnerable to be a part of the program. It says that broadening the inclusion criteria will align the Indian trials of Covishield with that of the ongoing global trials and test the vaccine for high-risk individuals and real-world distribution scenarios.
Moving on to Bangladesh, where the government has approved death penalty for rape. The cabinet took the decision after a series of rapes triggered massive protests across the country and people called out government's inaction. Earlier, the severest punishment for committing such a heinous crime amounted to life imprisonment, which, according to those supporting the decision, didn't create deterrence. While a number of cases remain unregistered, Bangladesh has reported nearly 1,000 rape cases in past 7 months, shaking the conscience of the people.
A large number of Bangladesh residents took to streets, hailing the government's decision of capital punishment to those who commit rape. The decision came in the wake of widespread protests that rocked the capital Dhaka and other parts of the country. The latest outpouring of national anger was sparked by a video of a group of men stripping and attacking a woman for almost half an hour in the southeastern district of Noakhali. It has been pulled down from the internet now. Since then, people have not just been demanding death to those rapists, but to all who are involved in such crimes. Government approval to their demand, they say, is the beginning of tough actions against crime.
গতকাল ধর্ষণের বিরুদ্ধে যে মৃত্যুদণ্ড কার্যকর হয়েছে আইন, সেটা যেন খুব দ্রুত কার্যকর হয়। একটা ধর্ষক যেন খুব দ্রুত তাকে শাস্তির আয়তায় আনতে পারি আমরা, এটাই আমাদের চাওয়া পাওয়া এখন।
Bangladesh has witnessed a surge in sexual crime in recent years. People and activists blame the government for not being assertive enough in dealing with the crime. Dhaka-based Aino Salish Kendra, one non-government civil rights and legal aid organization, said in its recent findings that nearly 1,000 incidents were reported between January and September this year, out of which 20% were gang rapes. A 2013 UN multi-country survey found that most of those who admitted to committing rape didn't suffer any legal consequences. The attackers are rarely held to account. The conviction rate for rape in Bangladesh is below 1%. A few activist groups say that the government is moving forward in the right direction.
সহিংসতা বন্ধে যে মৃত্যুদণ্ড বিধানটাকে আইন প্রণয়ন করেছেন এটাকে আমরা সাধুবাদ জানাই কিন্তু শুধুমাত্র আইন করে কিংবা প্রয়োগ করে কি এটা সম্ভব না আমরা যদি একটা সুস্থ স্বাভাবিক ভালো সমাজ পাইতে চাই নারীর প্রতি সহিংসতা কমাইতে চাই তাহলে অবশ্যই মার্শাল আর্ট বা কারাতের মতো বিষয়গুলো আমাদের বিভিন্ন শিক্ষা প্রতিষ্ঠানে প্রাতিষ্ঠানিকভাবে ছড়াই দিতে হবে
A few others, including the Human Rights Watch, is skeptical of the idea of capital punishment and says that hanging criminals won't curb the crime rate. They believe that authorities needed to immediately address systemic problems in rape trials and extremely low conviction rates. A few also blame the increasing number of assaults on a culture of impunity and protection of suspects by influential individuals for political reasons.
Moving on, the illegally occupied region of Gilgit-Baltistan has been rocked by widespread protests. While people are demanding release of political activists on one side, they want Pakistan to withdraw its intention of altering the status of the region. The protests that started with limited force have now mobilized people of GB origin across Pakistan.
A wave of anger has swept towns and villages across the illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan after the administration launched a crackdown on activists, dissenters and everybody who has not fallen in line with the arbitrary orders of the government. People from this illegally occupied region are carrying out massive demonstrations against what they call a systematic clampdown on their civil and political liberties. While they demand the immediate release of the political activists who have been sentenced on trumped-up charges, they also plan to launch a resistance drive against Islamabad's attempts to change the political status of occupied Gilgit-Baltistan to make it as the fifth province of Pakistan. They say they will sacrifice themselves but will not let Pakistan alter the status of the region. People from Gilgit-Baltistan who have been living in other Pakistani towns have also taken to the streets against Islamabad's arbitrary decision.
जब तक हमारे भाई बाहर नहीं आएंगे हम सब अंदर जाने के लिए तैयार हैं
बेशक
हम असीरा ने मुंदारी हाई कमेटी के अगले ऐलान के मुंतजिर हैं वो जब भी ऐलान की बोल देंगे हम इंशाल्लाह इसी तरह दियामत से दरेल से चीकर से लेके गुजरात के बॉर्डर तक तमाम भाई मिलके कराची से लेके इस्लामाबाद में लाहौर में पाकिस्तान के तमाम बड़े शहरों में अपने एहतजाजी मुजाहरे करेंगे अगर धरने देने पड़े तो हम सब मिलके इंशाल्लाह धरने देंगे
गिलगित-बल्तिस्तान earlier known as northern areas has been governed by Gilgit-Baltistan Empowerment and Self-Governance Order of 2009 that established an electoral framework. Elections have been held in the region under the order that provides the only limited autonomy. Islamabad wants to subsume it with Pakistan. Locals are determined against it. Leaders whose appeals have resonated with the mass have sought unity amongst the people as they believe Pakistan could capitalize on existing fault lines. They have also asked people to brace themselves for any flare-up.
Pakistan ka
पंजाब से ब्यूरोक्रेसी आकर हमारे लोगों को टारगेट करके दबाया जाता है। आज हमारे लोगों की बिजनेस मफलूज है, आज हमारे छोटे कारोबारी तबका वो भी मफलूज का शिकार है, आज हमारे यहाँ के मेहनत कश तबके के घरों में फाके पड़ चुके हैं। हमें उठना होगा, नहीं तो एक एक करके हमें इसी तरह सिसक सिसक के ये मार देंगे। आपको कमर किसके खड़ा होना होगा।
An intensified movement was the only way to ensure release of their fellow citizens. They have asked the authorities to release all of them before scheduled elections of 15th November in Gilgit-Baltistan. Pakistan has for decades been plundering the Gilgit-Baltistan of its resources. The locals on the other side, who have a prerogative over the land, are reeling under abject poverty, as they receive zero in dividends. And demanding rights is an unwritten crime in Gilgit-Baltistan. Anybody who has dared raise his voice against this discrimination have been subject to intimidation, arrest, torture and imprisonment.
There are many festivals in Nepal during which people worship idols of god and goddesses with much adoration and traditional fervor. The onset of the much awaited Durga Puja in the Himalayan nation means not only festivities but also opportunities for artists and sculptors to make good profits. However, this year the artists are disheartened with dwindled buyers due to the coronavirus pandemic. The festivities are marred with restrictions to contain the spread of infection, and therefore there are no grand celebrations being witnessed this year. Have a look.
Durga Puja is just around the corner. Made with clay and hay straws, these lifelike Durga idols are the product of days of hard labor of the idol makers. The idol makers start in much ahead of the biggest festival, Durga Puja, in the Himalayan nation. But this year, they are in despair with dwindled business and negligible takers for their idols ahead of the annual festival. Usually, the festival of Durga Puja is celebrated with much pomp and show. However, with the coronavirus restriction in place, the festivities this year remained rather dull and somber.
Set hoina set ta yo durga ko jamma 3-4 set jancha ani biskarma ko jancha 6 ota jati e yo barsha ma ta gaina yo barsha ma chapat cha byapar yo es pali 2 set durga gayo teti ho gako chaina.
One of the Nepalese sculptures, Phulan Devi, makes the ornament and jewelry that the goddess idols are decorated with. Her two sons and husband help in making and painting and putting the dress on the idols. The family of four resides in a humble shanty which they call Karkhana, and make idols around the year for various festivals. As the celebrations this year are muted, sales have dipped down, that has brought losses to the family, which has been relying on the business for their livelihood.
अब त यो लकडाउन भयो, कोरोना भाइरस आयो नि त, त्यसले गरेर भएन, बन्द भयो, न त बन्द भएन भने त व्यापार हुन्थ्यो मेरो, यो बन्द भयो।
A set of Durga idol, which has more than half a dozen idols, takes nearly 2 weeks to be completed for delivery to the clients. Clay, hay straws and husks are used to make the idols. Bamboo sticks and other raw material are used to give support to the structure, which takes around 3 days to dry up and ready for spray paint. Goddess Durga, Saraswati, Lakshmi, Lord Kartik, and Lord Ganesha, along with idols of demons Mahisasur, Ansumbha, and Nisumbha are included in the set. Autumn is the season for Kathmandu Valley's traditional festivals in Nepal, where religious celebrations and rituals are a big part of the lives. But people this year have scaled down their rituals within their homes.
Coronavirus has severely affected the economies around the world. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.